CAMPO, a space to debate, study and celebrate architecture.
Thank you very much for coming. It's a great pleasure to have here Peter Wilson to present this exhibition, which will be open for about a month. Until mid-November, and which presents a very specific work of him, which is not directly his architectural work, but the work that together with Julia are doing in Wallace and Wilson, but it's a travel through, we could say a tour of the tour, in a way, which is a kind of investigation, which is not historical, not really even scientific in a way, but it's an investigation through drawing and through intellectual curiosity in revisiting what has been the grand tour, this idea of intellectual from all over Europe coming into Italy to see the wonders, the ruins of the Italian landscape, and I think it shows a very peculiar intelligence through this kind of tour, and of course something that is perhaps today almost disappearing, which is this kind of ability to, in a very precise but also very reduced way, kind of gives back certain kind of ideas and also atmospheres and emotions through drawings which are not necessarily purely architectural but actually span through architecture, landscape or art, we could say, and also the idea that there is, I think, a very interesting idea of about the copy or the kind of reinterpretation of things, of landscapes or of other paintings, which altogether constitute a sort of what we would call a kind of landscape of fantasy, landscape of imagination, which perhaps is a component as a base then of the architectural work. So I think it's an exhibition which is in a certain sense different from what you've done so far, because it's really focused on an idea of investigation and drawing, and I think it would be that's what also we ask in a way to Peter to present, which is an idea of about drawing and what is drawing today in an age in which somehow it seems that this mean is kind of losing its importance or its relevance for the architectural world, or at least it's taking a different path from what has been, for example, for the grand tourists which would come here to draw Roman ruins and to draw the Italian landscape in general. So I would leave the word to Peter, which will lead us through certain slides. Thank you.
Say a few words first. I have a couple of things that I must say first. One is a thank you and one is an apology. First, a thank you to CAMPO. I've never seen an exhibition go up as quickly as this. It's a very professional team, very, very good atmosphere. It's really, really nice to come here and to work and to have an audience like this. I think this is something very exceptional. One doesn't find it in many other countries, this collaboration between architects. Well done. The apology is the apology about the subject of the work. The work is about Italy, but you are all Italian and you will probably not recognize your country in this work, because I'm drawing Italy as we foreigners see and have seen Italy. I'm doing a history of travelers to Italy, which is a very English thing to do, the English Grand Tour. that I'm doing it because I myself am Australian, so I've inherited English culture, but I'm also very critical of the English. I think the English are very, very clever at stealing the world, and they stole my country from the Aborigines. They stole a lot from Italy, but I think the Italians were clever than the English, because most of the antiques that the English imported were fakes. So England is full of what the English think are Roman statues, but they are glued together from the hand from one statue and the foot made by a kind of artist. I think my exhibition is in a way post-colonial. The result of my research as an English travelling in Italy is that the English were not interested in Italy in general. They were not interested in the Baroque, which was happening when they were here. They were only interested in Imperial Rome. Why were they doing that? Because they were building the English Empire around the world, and they wanted food and crops for their empire. And they wanted to make the equivalent between the Roman Emperor and the English King, which is, if they transported statues and put them in front of English country houses, they were doing that. If they imported paintings by Poussin, they were importing Italian landscape to interpret as English landscape gardens. They were making England into Italy. A very strange act of transfer, perhaps an act of theft. The exhibition is about drawing, but it's not about drawing on paper. You'll see that all the paintings are on MDF. They actually, you're not meant to touch them, but they do open. They are objects. As an architect, we design objects, and we work two-dimensionally but think three-dimensionally. And my intention with these works was to produce three-dimensional objects which had the substance. We had just built a museum in Albania, a museum of icons of the Greek Orthodox Church. And what I really like with the icons is they're painted on wood, which is this thick. The wood is eaten by worms, the worms make a hole in the picture. And the picture is like a ruin in Rome. It's got the patina of time. It tells the story of its history. I think the exhibition is about the relationship of drawing to architecture, about the relationship to history, which is something which we must not forget with our instant cultures of instant media. And the question of cultural context, which is what I said about the English in Italy. But my drawings are not only about the English in Italy. This one, for example, is a German. It's a very nice story where his wife's diary, when he had to leave Rome, he had tears in his eyes and he could not speak, and he was so fond of being here. In fact, his first trip to Italy, he had a stipendium to come here and copy some paintings and stay 4 years longer than he was meant to. The Prussians in Berlin were worried that he had taken the money and wasn't going to come back. So they sent Schinkel to come and get him. But being a clever painter, he painted a portrait of Schinkel as soon as Schinkel arrived, and Schinkel liked the portrait and said, good guy, I like him. And wrote a very positive report about him. Anyway, these are all stories. And all of these pictures have stories. The book has all the stories. On the wall, there are summaries of the stories. I would recommend that you... I recommend that you buy the book, of course. And the book is... It's a pocket book. It has the proportions of a Baedeker. A Baedeker is the famous German guidebook for travelers. It's a pocket book, which is why I'm demonstrating how pocket books are meant to work. I think you can turn the lights out now, and I'll say a little bit more about drawing and architecture. The works on the wall, there's only one work of art, which I consider a piece of architecture of Orson Wilson on the wall. The reason for this is the AA publishers who first put on this exhibition and made the book. They edited all Boris Wilson architecture out of the book because they're very nervous about monographs, about architects who want to do a PR exercise pushing themselves. So I'm meant to be, with this book, I'm meant to be an academic, but actually I'm an architect. And to demonstrate that, I'll show some of my drawings about cities and urban planning. my idea about drawing, or when I draw, I consider myself to be learning or teaching myself the DNA of a city. This is a drawing, a painting I did in Taipei. It has a whole pattern of the city, one big building like your aqueduct here, lots of little features, predominant colors in the next one. Similarly, a drawing of Tokyo. We were lucky enough to work in the 1990s in Tokyo, and I started drawing these little sketches of Tokyo, little mappings of the city, because Tokyo for me was completely foreign. It was not like coming to Italy, which is part of Europe, and one understands the rules of the city. In Tokyo, one did not understand how the city was composed. It is not concentric, it is not hierarchical. One came to the conclusion that it was made up of lots of isolated incidents floating, like little pieces of meat in a soup or something. So this is a sketch of Tokyo from my sketchbook. Next one. This is also Tokyo, but this is actually the site plan for a project. We built a house in Tokyo, but we never managed to find in a map of Tokyo where the house is. We do not know as architects where our building is. This is the only site plan we ever drew, which was called the Tokyo Cloud, and that's our house floating in the Tokyo Cloud. So one can see here that the drawing actually becomes the tool for producing or for presenting the architecture. And the next one is the house itself, I hope. Yes, that's the house itself. Maybe you know it from your crocus. Okay, back in Italy. This is our project in Perugia. For us, a very important project, because the generation we belong to, the Italian city, was always our reference for urban planning, the block, and the dense spaces. But I think now what interests me most is the choreography of spaces, this sort of flowing from one to another, layering of textures and of materials. This is our project in Perugia. On top is the sketch of the facade of the monastery, which is the facade of the new urban quarter we're building in Perugia, Monte Lucia. On the bottom is a sketch I did in my sketchbook on the plane flying back to Germany for the first site visit. This sketch is actually the basis of our design, of our master plan for Monte Lucia. So one sees here that the sketching is actually a process. It's actually, it leads directly the project. And the next one. This is the model we made for the competition in Monte Lucia. The model is made from wood, like these paintings. We have a wood workshop in our office. We believe very much in materials, you know, in the tactic, the haptic of touching materials. For Perugia, we invented a whole load of trees. These trees here at the bottom are our plexiglass interpretations of Italian pines. And we painted the soil with burnt umbria, this is the color which one associates with Perugia. Here, the site was a very steep mountain. The whole area at the top of that picture is our master plan. It's a 19th century hospital now converted into a new urban quarter. I don't want to talk about to do an architectural lecture, so I'm going to move. Next one. The drawings are still for us the tool one uses. We have now a number of projects in Albania. This is a big project you see on the left, the high-rise hotel. The hotel lobby, as the most important space in the hotel, I drew myself by hand with a pencil and use this drawing. Drawings like this have an advantage. I showed this to the Prime Minister of Albania, Edi Rama, and he said to me, Peter, build that, build just that, don't build anything else. I think it's what one really wants to hear as an architect from a Prime Minister. And so our client was also there, he also donated, and I hope he listened. Next one. Also in Albania, this is in the city of Korce, way up in the mountains, almost in Greece. It's a public space, a piazza, it's called the Theatre Square. And as you all know in Italy, a public or a square must have a campanile. We told them in Albania they had to have a campanile in the square. I did this sketch called the Ring of Blood in the Sky. So the staircase with the bar on top, and at the bottom you see they're skating in Albania. Luckily they found a Greek company who specialized in ice skating. Not maybe the best business choice for a Greek company, but it worked, and in Albania they skate in winter. It's soon going to be able to ski in winter in this part of Albania. We are doing the master plan for a ski resort. Next. This is the red bar in the sky in Goethe in Albania. You see the tower and the red bar on top.
Is that the last image? Probably is.
No. Another drawing. This is today by chance we wandered between the station and here, past some Roman ruins, and this wonderful building with the circular holes in it. I'm not sure what it's called.
Tomba del Fornai. La tomba del Fornai.
Yeah, this one, yes. This was my model for this apartment building. So, a piece of Rome exported to Albania. Another reason for traveling to Italy. This is now being drawn up by our Albanian partner office. It's an apartment building where each apartment has two circular holes. I think this is all I really want to say. It's very nice of you all to come tonight. Thank you very much. And being here tonight is another reason to travel to Italy.
Responsibility.
You want to say something?
draw. That's the trouble. I stopped drawing when Peter, when we got together and so on, because he draws so well that I dropped it. And that's actually a disadvantage. But I don't know. I think there's a good book by Flann O'Brien, an Irish writer, sort of. It's a long story. It's about a policeman riding a bicycle and the molecules of the policeman and the bicycle, they start interchanging. And I think we've been married for such a long time that hopefully I'm sort of adopting a little bit to his Australian Anglo-Saxon sensibility, and Peter has adopted quite a lot of Central European, German rationality. So I don't know.
The Irish story is that after a lifetime of the policeman riding his bicycle, the bicycle was one third policeman, and the policeman was one third bicycle. Because of the expense of
the bicycle.
I think that I don't like the word style. No? What I really like is not the idea of style, but is the idea of the currents of the method of work. I'm sure that, of course, you did a lot of travel to Italy and you collect fragments, but I believe that the dialogue between you two and those fragments, that I'm sure that you collect sketch and fragments also when you are in other city, in other country. And what I like very much is that today there are not a lot of architects that declare the way of working that they have in the office. So they say they try to build a theory around the construction of the building, and in that case there is what I call the weak theory, is the idea of a method of work that collects for and works for all the architects. I believe that each of us collects fragments of the reality, and our work and your work is perfect. And this is a kind of reinterpretation of this kind of atlas of the memory that we have, no? And we collect in different ways. So I think that it's not from my point of view a problem of style, but it's a problem of method of work. It's really very precise.
It's a question of cultural sampling, of actually taking on board information and experiences from outside, and being able to recycle those, and knowing how to interpret them.
So that you start your lecture and you say that, you know, you're in Italy and you're talking about the drawing of Italy, but we are really surprised to recognize a lot of fragments of our place, of the place that we know very well, in your, not drawing, but in all the project that you did along your career. So it's really very, I think that you get a lot from Italy, but also in your project you give back a lot of this kind of traveling movement around Italy in your project. So
this is the reason
thanks.
Of culture, it's a dialogue. But it's like your gallery. What I like about your gallery is it seems to be a forum for dialogue. This is something we absolutely miss in Germany, because when we meet with other architects, we all shoot at each other.
I am very curious about that, because I saw the book some months ago, thanks to David. I'm really curious about the history of your drawing in the book of Twombly. Can you explain the monkey story?
I don't know how the drawing came to be in the book. I think it was published somewhere in Belgium, and he saw it and took it. But our current paranoia about copyright did not exist then. So if you saw an image in another book that you liked, you copied it and put it in your book, which is what Twombly did. I think he put in the image of King Kong in the book to show, look at the crazy things these architects do. This is not architecture, this is a circus. I think that was his reason. And I think it was a critical quote.
Yeah.
But then, and for me, teaching the AA to have an image in the Twombly book, this was great. I was like, the only one who had an image in the Twombly book.
I have another curiosity that is about the text. Because, in a way, the book and the exhibition itself is also a lot about the text. And the narrative. So I wonder, maybe it's just a very simple curiosity about how, because this text is of course not an architect text, it's a kind of, let's say, literary text in a way, no? It's more about storytelling in a way. So I was wondering if you relate this, or how you relate this to your work, your architectural work, or whether this plays a role.
When we started teaching at the AA, and we were interested in the idea of narrative or in a readable architecture, architectural parlant, and I'm not sure now that people do read buildings there. I think you get much more instant information now from the net. But I think the idea that buildings could be readable is important. Well, it's not a function of the building, it's a function of the reader. It's how much you know and how many references you can call to mind when you look at an object or a painting or a building. I think this is an obligation we all have to work on. It's something that the German hermeneutic philosopher Gadamer talks about the project self. I think we all have an obligation to work on the project self, and the ability to read a building or to read a picture is something that one needs to learn and needs to practice.
Space to debate, study and celebrate architecture.